Hey, if you would like to learn the basics about ARP, I suggest you watch my previous video about the ARP protocol and how to add static entries to the ARP table. In this one, we're going to learn about ARP modes, reply only, proxy ARP, and local proxy ARP. This is not for the average user, so feel free to click away. Reply only is a unique, uncommon mode that is like an in-between enabled and disabled. To demonstrate this, I have two routers connected. Router 1 has ARP enabled and its Ether 1 is connected to Ether 1 on router 2, which currently has ARP disabled for that port. For these devices to be able to communicate using their IPs, they have static ARP entries added for each other. This is because ARP is a two-way communication, so disabling it on one router stops it from functioning altogether, and static entries are needed. This is not very convenient if only one of the devices is stationary and you want to reuse the same port that router 1 is connected to for several end devices. To avoid the hassle of adding static entries on the end devices, we could just use reply only mode so that we only have to manage one ARP table. I can delete the static ARP on router 1 and change the ARP mode to reply only on router 2, and IP communication still works. However, if I delete the static entry in router 2, IP no longer works between these two devices. That's how reply-only mode can be used to control layer 3 access. Next, we get proxy ARP mode. The idea behind it is very simple. A device can use its own MAC address to reply to ARP requests on behalf of other devices that it can reach itself. This allows ARP tables to automatically be populated with addresses that cannot be found in the same broadcast domain. To demonstrate it in action, I will start with a scenario where we have three routers, and one of them is acting as a gateway between the other two. ARP is currently enabled on all of them, but the ports in the gateway are not bridged, so routers 1 and 2 are in separate layer 2 broadcast domains. Router 2 is configured as usual and it's using the gateway as its default gateway, but router 1 does not have a default gateway set. Instead, it will use network/16 instead of /24, so it will behave like all three routers are in the same network, or in other words, in a 192.168 supernet. Let's see if R1 can communicate with R2. Trying to ping R2 results in timeouts. If we look at Wireshark, we can see that R1 is sending ARP requests to the gateway, expecting them to reach R2, but there is never any reply because the gateway just ignores them. R1 tried to add R2 to its ARP table, but the result is an entry without a MAC address. On the other hand, if we try to ping R1 from R2, it gets timed out as well, but in Wireshark, we can see that R2 is not trying to make any ARP requests. It is simply sending any packets that are destined to IP addresses outside of its network to the gateway. So the ping packets go to the gateway, and since it can successfully add both routers to its ARP table, the packets are sent correctly to R1. But of course, router 1 has no idea where to send the ping replies. We can keep the router 1 configuration as it is and make this setup functional by enabling proxy ARP on the gateway for Ether 1 that connects to the router 1. Now when I try to ping R2 from R1, it works. The ping packets are being sent to the IP of R2 using the MAC address of the gateway, as can be verified in the ARP table. Pinging router 1 from router 2, of course, also works without creating any additional ARP table entries. Both routers are communicating through the MAC addresses of the gateway, but only router 1 is using the gateway as an ARP proxy. The downside here is that R1 will try to add every IP address that you try to reach to its ARP table. It is not too bad if only a small number of devices can be reached through the gateway, as the gateway will not send ARP replies to addresses that it doesn't know how to reach. But if our gateway is also our access to the internet, then we could run into some trouble. I will configure this gateway properly for internet access. At this point, R2 can already begin using the internet. But on router 1, we still have to set the default gateway. Normally, we would specify the IP address of the gateway, but with proxy ARP, we can do something funny. We can use the interface name instead of an IP, and we should still be able to reach addresses on the internet. But as you can see, they are getting added to the ARP table with the same gateway MAC. This means that over time we will fill up this table with countless useless entries, and this router will get slowed down as compared to router 2. The moral of the story, there are countless ways to arrive at some dysfunctional configuration, and when it comes to ProxyRP, you probably don't want to use it, unless you have some solid reason for it. There aren't that many use cases, but here's one that might come in handy. Let's say you have several devices in a LAN joined by a bridge, so they can communicate with each other directly. But then you have a fourth device that connects to your gateway through VPN, and you would like it to just be on the same network. Well, then you could assign IP accordingly, but that is not enough. Devices from the LAN will try to reach it directly and get no response to their ARP requests. So that's where we could make use of ProxyRP by enabling it on the bridge interface on the gateway. Finally, what is local ProxyRP? That again is a very unique ARP mode that I'm not even sure is offered by other manufacturers. With this mode, we can perform ProxyRP between isolated ports while narrowing down the processing to only a single network. And the local refers to a single local network. Another distinct feature is that this mode only works with a single interface, so the ARP replies will not be sent about IP addresses from other interfaces. So how can we do ProxyRP between isolated ports if we only work with one interface? Well, there are two ways that we could do this. One is to create a bridge with isolated ports and use local ProxyRP on the bridge interface, so we are doing ProxyRP between the bridged ports. And the other option would be to apply local ProxyRP to a single physical interface and then connect it to a switch that forwards several of its isolated ports to this proxy interface. Here is an example of the bridge method. Again, I have two routers with IP addresses from the same network. This time, however, the gateway simply bridges the two ports, and I have also added an IP address to the bridge interface. So if router 1 makes any ARP requests, they reach router 2 and they can communicate directly. Now I will isolate the ports using a horizon. The bridge currently has ARP set to enable. If I go to the bridge port section, I can set both ports to use horizon 1. We don't have to use number 1, it can be any number as long as it is the same number. The ports become isolated from one another on layer 2. And they will only exchange layer 2 frames with bridge ports that have a different horizon value. If we now try to ping router 2 from router 1, it no longer works. To fix this, we can enable local ProxyRP on the bridge. Trying to ping again might not work straight away, as the routers are still trying to use the old ARP entries. But if you give it a moment or manually clear the old ARP tables, then R1 and R2 will be able to communicate using the gateway as an ARP proxy. What this has allowed us to do is to join two devices in a single network, in this case the 192.168.0 network, while not sharing the broadcast domain. The usual options are to either bridge the two ports, creating a single broadcast domain, or to assign addresses from two separate networks or subnets and then route the traffic between them. I will wrap up this exploration of some rather unusual ARP modes. This is not something for the average routerized user, but if at least one person makes use of this, then maybe the stupid amount of time I spent on this rather small specific video was worth it. I will get back to making some VLAN videos now. Take care.